Hello, everyone, and welcome to Collider Nightmares. Thank you so much for watching. It's good to see you on this beautiful Wednesday morning. My name is Clarke Wolfe, and we've got a big, big, big show for you today. We're going to be rehashing all of American Horror Story Roanoke, Channel Zero, Candle Cove. We're talking It Follows later in the show, so you got to stay tuned. But first, before we get to any of that, let's introduce our panel. To my left is Miss Perri Nemiroff.
I know I say this all the time, but this lineup, like when we get, I did it again, damn it, when we get to this section, I'm so excited.
It's going to be a big one. And to her left is Mr. John Schnepp.
That's right. It's Wednesday morning. I'm really excited about that area in that
the teeth area. Monster.
Oh wait, this over right there. This area.
One day I'll get it right.
And the tooth monster. And to my right is Mr. Mark Reilly.
Hey everyone. Yeah, I'm excited about that.
Oh,
over
he
there
got
and,
it right.
And everything, because it's time to talk horror stuff.
Yeah.
Because it's right before Thanksgiving, and I'm ready to start watching some of this stuff that we're going to talk about.
Yes, I am excited too.
For
all of your escapist Thanksgiving needs when you're spending time with your glorious families, like I'm about to do.
A lot of silence.
Yeah, lots
weird,
of
weird silences.
Lots of drinks. All the drinks. Sometimes, mostly with hard alcohol.
All
anyway, why don't we go ahead and just get into our topics now, starting with our first fresh meat topic of the day.
Fresh
turkey meat, you might say. So first up, The Walking Dead is in full swing over on AMC. And of course, the zombie drama shows no signs of slowing down. Already renewed for an eighth season, series creator Robert Kirkman recently revealed that AMC themselves doesn't even know how the show would end, and we discussed his comments here on Nightmares. Now, showrunner Scott M. Gimple has added fuel to a different fire, telling comicbook.com that a feature film version of the hit show would probably happen eventually, saying, quote, "I'm sure one way or another, one day it'll happen. I think it would be cool." Now, Gimple went on to tease fans, suggesting that William Shatner could play Rick Grimes, Edward James Olmos could step in as Daryl, and Matthew Fox could have a stint as the governor. So clearly he's just having a little fun. But just last year, Andrew Lincoln expressed his enthusiasm for a feature, if for no other reason than a break from the sweltering temperatures of the Atlanta production. And yeah, maybe planning with some other timelines would be cool too. Now, we have some big Walking Dead fans here at the table. So I'm going to start to my right with Mr. Mark Reilly. The prospect. Now, obviously, Gimple was kind of being a little offhand, and I think he was being a little goofy and joking around. But still, the talk of the Walking Dead movie has been going around for a long time. So, Reilly, as a fan of the show, would you like to see a feature film? And if so, what would that entail?
I would love to see a feature film. And I think it needs to be contingent on the series ending. I would love to see the series lead into and be the last episode of the series, lead in, set up the movie, and then the movie ends it all. Like, we get a big, epic finale, two-hour movie that kind of wraps up this. Because what scares me about Walking Dead, and I've heard this from Kirkman, is he said this about maybe the comics, too, that there's, like, no end. That, now, I've heard this a number of times. There's no end. The zombie apocalypse just kind of goes on forever, and it's all about the survival, whether it goes into some other characters or not. It makes me go, are we never going to figure out how this happened? That's what I've always... I'm mixed on that because I think it's interesting and in a dark premise to think that it could never end and that these characters are just, this is their life now for the rest of their life. So that'd be fun to see as a movie. But I don't, as far as what Kirkman's thoughts are on that, on actually ending it, beside the point. Me, I would love a movie. I think that there's a lot of potential only if, like they've talked about it with Game of Thrones, mm-hmm. like, you know, you finish the series, you go into a big epic movie. So the, that's what I think.
Okay, now Perri, so it sounds like Riley's interested in maybe a chronological storytelling, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas with Andrew Lincoln's comments from about a year ago, he was saying, look, it could be cool to explore different timelines and travel around in the timing of the mythology. Does that interest you as a fan? And if so, or if not, what would you like to see from a feature film?
It's hard to say no, because if they ever did any type of Walking Dead movie, my butt would be in that seat and I would be thrilled to see it. However, I don't think this is a good idea at all. These These comments, you're right, are definitely just him casually say. I mean, how many times out there has an actor or a producer or a writer, director, whatnot said, oh, wouldn't it be great to do this? And all of a sudden you get a headline saying Walking Dead movie in the works. So let's just never get carried away in that respect here. But I don't. The comments about switching the roles are that's even whether or not he was actually joking and bringing this up at all. That's a little ridiculous. I don't think there's any business in these characters going on to a movie, but at the same time, if we're gonna explore a different timeline or a different group of survivors, why not just not make it a Walking Dead film and make it another original zombie idea? Mm-hmm. Another idea where they could bring Walking Dead to the big screen is to do what they're doing with Game of Thrones and now Inhumans, which is make some episodes, shoot them in IMAX, and have a theatrical event out of it. I was lucky enough to have been to that Madison Square Garden screening of the season premiere of season 6. And even though that wasn't on, you know, like the best projector with the best screen and lights and whatnot, that was one heck of a cinematic event. So I think there's a lot of potential in that. But I don't, you know, what other TV shows out there have had successful movies? We just had Veronica Mars and Entourage. I didn't see either of them, so I don't know quality-wise how they are. But I don't think they did very well. So, but then again, you know, Walking Dead is a completely different beast.
Yeah, it's interesting because I'll put it to you, Schnepp. You know, the idea of communal viewing experiences. So Walking Dead is very much a communal thing. People get together in bars, you know, on Sunday nights they watch the show, or they get together with their friends and they watch the show. Same with Game of Thrones. I would, to your point about what films have or TV shows have successfully translated, the thing that jumped to my mind was Sex and the City. Mm-hmm. That movie,
gonna say that too.
Yeah, and that movie was a huge success. The first one,
movie.
Look, I mean, I like the second one too, and the second one made money, but the first one is considered a success.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think is because women got together and watched that show as a group. It was a communal experience. So, Schnepp, do you think that communal viewing would have anything to do with the success of a Walking Dead movie?
Well, I think it, like, you know, in my opinion, making a Walking Dead film, I don't ever want a conclusion or, you know, we've got the antidote. That to me is meaningless. That's not what The Walking Dead is about. I don't need an ending. The ending to me would be a nuclear bomb. The entire planet is destroyed. I mean, because that's what it's about. It's about humans against humans. The Walking Dead is all metaphor. For me, like, I would love to see a Walking Dead movie that took place in the same world that Rick and everyone else are in, but none of them are in it.
Mm-hmm.
Or if we had a spinoff, one of those characters leaves in season 8 and you don't know what happened to them, you see the movie and then you see the fate of that character. And that way you can do multiple Walking Dead movies. This is like The Walking Dead, Rick, or whatever. It's they each have a subtitle. That's the way I'd like to see it. A standalone Walking Dead in a different timeline doesn't interest me.
I wonder if the response to Fear the Walking Dead would... I mean, Fear the Walking Dead is doing well enough that it's going into a third season, but clearly Fear is not as big as Walking Dead. I just wonder if that would kind of deter them from exploring a different group of survivors in the same apocalypse.
Yeah, I don't think so. I mean, if they keep it just called The Walking Dead, I think the thing that is throwing Fear the Walking Dead off is the title. I mean, people are like, what is this? I don't even know what this is. It's very simple. They just added Fear. It's like,
yeah, and it's not really, it doesn't feel as connected to that world, which might have been a mistake.
Yeah, no, and I think with Walking Dead, it's all contingent on the story they'd want to tell if they're going to go and do a movie, and whether or not it's set up right in the actual show. Personally, because I love the cast, I would want to see it on the big screen. But that's if they have an ending in mind. That's if the cast can go. And if it's worthy of an actual story to tell on the big screen. I certainly have stories in my head that I would want to see. But I look at it's one of the biggest ratings in cable. So I think fans of The Walking Dead will show up. And it could be a successful movie because it is a zombie movie. They could do it on a decent budget. So I look at it that way as well.
Very interesting. Well, we'll keep you posted as more details emerge, which they will not. But we'll keep you posted in case they magically do. So let's go ahead and move on. Now, last week, I had the pleasure of attending a luncheon in honor of the Blu-ray release of Don't Breathe, Fede Alvarez's smash thriller, which is available to own next week. Now, we'll be talking all about the Don't Breathe scoops that we got on next week's episode of Nightmares. So be sure sure to tune in. But until we do, we thought it would be fun to share some other details of a much-anticipated Sam Raimi title, the produced feature film adaptation of the hit video game The Last of Us. Announced in 2014 using a script written by Naughty Dog's Neil Druckmann, there had been rumors about who the movie would star and what it would entail. Then, earlier this year, Druckmann told IGN News that the film had entered development hell and, quote, there hasn't been any work done on it in over a year and a half. That's not promising. And last week at the luncheon, IGN's Jim Vevita followed up with Raimi asking for an update, and the news wasn't so great. Quote, Neil's plan for it is not the same as Sony's, and because my company, Ghost House Pictures, doesn't have the rights, I actually can't help him too much. Even though I'm one of the producers on it, the way he set it up, he sold the rights to Sony, Sony hired me as a producer by chance, and I can't get the rights free for him, so I'm not in the driver's seat, and I can't tell you what Sony and Neil together will decide on. If they do move forward, I'd love to help them again. So this was a video game adaptation that so many of you guys were excited about, and certainly when Girl with All the Gifts started running its trailers and had its European release, a lot of people are saying, hey, this is just like The Last of Us. Riley, I know you love this game.
Yeah.
You know, did you want to see this movie? And was it, I mean, this is kind of bummer news, huh?
Yeah, it's a bit of a bummer. I mean, I forgot that they were actually, that this was in development, but when they announced it, I played the game, and by far is one of the most cinematic, wonderful games written in the video game genre. Mm-hmm. Like, I was surprised at how much I cared about the story. The story is what is the central. So what I'm looking at with Druckmann is that he needs to do his adaptation. Sony needs to let him do it because he wrote the video game, he directed the video game, he's now writing the script on this. He knows it so well. I don't want to see Sony try to water this down or do something. We haven't had a successful, arguably, successful video game adaptation. I think this one has the potential because of the story. It's kind of in the zombie genre. I know they don't call them zombies, but it has that. But you focus on the central relationship between, I forget their names. Is it in here? The girl and the guy who... it's a great relationship, so it really could transfer well on screen. And Raimi, I wish he could help because I feel like he has that clout, but obviously he's just kind of a gun for hire right now. But my advice, Sony, come on, step aside. Let Druckmann in there.
Well, you know, this is going to be an interesting year for video game adaptations when all is said and done, because Warcraft came out, you know, it obviously made a ton of money internationally, but here in the domestic market, not so much. However, Assassin's Creed is coming this Christmas. Yep. Schnepp, do you think that if Assassin's Creed is a huge hit, Sony might reinvigorate this process and come back to the project?
It's possible, but I feel like it's more Sony wants to go one way and Druckmann is his mm-hmm. name wants to go another way, and that's where you're not going to get an even thing. That's what Sam is trying to say, is like, look, I as a producer tried to bring them together, but I have no power. What he's basically saying is it's not going to happen mm-hmm. until one of them gives up, and Sony's probably not going to give up.
I wonder, Perri, do you think that maybe there's like a reversion clause in the contract? Maybe Druckmann could get the rights back if Sony doesn't actually do something with it?
Sadly, I don't know what's in the fine print of his contract, but this story is a major, major red flag to me. I've never played the game, but I've watched enough trailers and gameplay footage, and I've researched enough to know that this thing does have a very cinematic story. And even just reading the Wikipedia page, it's pretty freaking engaging. So I would like to see it done the way he wants, but if they're having the dreaded term creative differences mm-hmm. with the guy who was behind the game, there's something seriously wrong with this partnership right now. And my mind just keeps going back to that movie, The Fifth Wave, that Sony put out earlier this year, because that's one of the best young adult books that I've read. I was so excited about that director, Jay Blakeson, finally getting to make another feature film. And then when it came out, it was nothing like the source material. It was nothing like what Jay Blakeson had achieved in his first feature film. And I worry that the studio will push this project in a similar direction. So part of me just kind of hopes it completely falls apart at this point, because I'd rather not spoil the game for people who are so dedicated and love it so much.
Let me ask you this. If we could get it away from Sony, who seems to be sticking their business in all these adaptations, like you just mentioned with that one. What if we gave it to an actual studio that was like a Marvel or a Pixar or a Lucasfilm? I always picture, because they're so hands-off with their filmmakers, they trust them to make that, because I think that's what this title needs.
Or even just if Sam Raimi can claim it for Ghost House. Absolutely. And they can just make it by themselves. But like, based on his quotes, it does not seem it's going to go
that
way.
You could just see The Girl with All the Gifts, which is an incredible film. Which is very similar to The Last of Us.
Yeah. Schnepp and I saw Girl with All the Gifts, and it still doesn't have a U.S. release. I don't know how this is possible.
For real.
I looked it up after I screened it at, we screened it at Beyond Fest, and I cannot find details of a U.S. release.
I guess I'll just have to keep watching and rewatching Train to Busan until I can see that one again.
Which does have a U.S. release now, finally, this holiday season. So, yay. okay, well, we'll keep you posted on The Last of Us, too. Hopefully that news will go better than The Walking Dead movie that I don't think will ever happen. So, moving on. Now for some completely original horror offerings from Darren Lynn Bousman, director of Saw 2 through 4, Repo: The Genetic Opera and The Devil's Carnival, comes Abattoir, written by 12 Monkeys scribe Chris Monfette. Abattoir stars Jessica Lowndes and Lynn Shea and tells the story of a mysterious man who has been buying houses where tragedies have occurred. Set in a world where it always feels like night, even in daylight hours, real estate reporter Julia Talbin's life is turned upside down when her family is brutally murdered. It is believed to be an open and closed case, but Julia quickly realizes there is much more to the story when she returns to the crime scene to find the murderer room deconstructed and physically removed from her sister's home. Who could be embarking on this crazy endeavor? The enigmatic Jebediah Crone has built the Abattoir, a monstrous house stitched together with unending rooms of death and the damned. So that's a really interesting premise, and the trailer is out for you to see. The movie hits theaters and VOD on December 9th, and I reached out to Chris Monfette because I know him from 12 Monkeys, and he wanted to tell this to the audience. He said, we tried to create something that felt unique, that approached the old idea of the haunted house in a new way. Darren's always had a fascination with film noir, so we decided in terms of the language of the film, from the dialogue to the design, to take that 50s noir sensibility and combine it with a modern haunted house story. It all feels very anachronistic and timeless, and hopefully unsetting. It's a very specific film, very stylized, which has become a hallmark for Darren. We played it at a number of festivals and gotten a lot of incredibly positive reactions. It's been a long road to get the film this far, so we're thankful to the folks who have seen it and written about it, and hopefully the wider audiences will enjoy it. I think this premise is absolutely brilliant. The idea of going to different crime scenes and taking the room where the horrible thing happened and building one giant house out of murder rooms to unleash demons and ghosts and the supernatural. Schnepp, I'll start with you. You know, what are your thoughts on this?
I love the idea. I love what the writer said. And then, you know, the Jebediah Crone, the cop from Sons of Anarchy shows up. You know, I mean, I'll have to see the film. You know, the trailer kind of half sold me. It feels a lot like Sinister. It feels like that weird, like we're in the ghost world now. And obviously that's what's going to happen with all these murder rooms. The idea is pretty powerful. I just want to see the execution of it. But the trailer sold me on it. So, you know, I'm into seeing it. I don't want it to be corny. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping it's not corny, but I hope it falls more into the like scary, weird, freaky, haunted house rooms. So.
Yeah, I'm hoping the visuals hold up because I think this could be such a very visual film. Perri, how about you?
What wound up selling me on the trailer? I didn't love the trailer, but the image that got me was the end when you just see the house kind of stacked up and just that funny looking visual that's really eerie, and just even the title card that says someone is building the ultimate haunted house paired with that image, that piques my interest. You know, there's a couple things in this trailer that rubbed me the wrong way, like you're getting too close to this one, because I haven't heard that line 500 times before, and you know, I'm not the biggest fan of this this poster either. Anything that's bathed in red always makes me think of the Cabin Fever poster. And this in particular, I think that image spoils the look of the house a little. I would have just taken the actual shot from the trailer and from the footage of the film and used that, because it's so strong. I saw somebody else use that image as the thumbnail when they uploaded the trailer. I would click on that. Why don't you just use that? And to nitpick a little more, I was reading the official synopsis, and it's not the most well-written synopsis where things feel redundant, where, I don't know, it just feels like they didn't know how to explain certain things in an interesting way, and there's just so many elements of it that feel a little cliche. Just the idea of her being a reporter, like she's investigating in a reporter, and she wasn't really selling it for me, and then like the ex-lover detective. There's certain connections that make me worried that it's gonna come across as silly and too cliche and cartoonish. But on the other hand, the idea of building the ultimate haunted house, I think, has all the potential in the world, visually, narratively. So I'm curious enough. It has tipped the scale in the positive direction, so I'm probably going
to
check it out.
I would volley, though, that that's them trying to do the film noir.
That's exactly, you know, what I
reporter,
was about to say.
The detective.
Like a gumshoe.
Which would have worked if certain... delivery of certain lines.
Well, you know, that's fair.
Didn't make me roll my eyes.
And I think that there's something to be said for like stylized dialogue and seeing it out of context. You know, the idea of like, if you're going to enter, for instance, we know from what I just read that this is a world where there's no daylight or no daytime. Yeah. So this is a, what am I trying to say? Like a very extreme or fantastical kind of world.
Like an alternate universe.
Exactly.
If they're doing this. Yeah. Which I dig that portion of it, and I love the log line too, the ultimate, you know, haunted house. That gets me every time. And I'm kind of with you, Perri. The trailer was all right for me, but because of the premise and the talent behind it, I'm willing to give it a chance, because I think it's a very fine line. When you tell me you're going to take a room out of each horror scene and then put it together in the ultimate haunted house, that is a very fine line to make that work. And I'm curious. I want to see it work, and I want to see it work really, really well. And I like the alternate universe, a world with no daylight, because that tells me a lot right there. So I'm cautiously optimistic as well. This trailer didn't do it for me. It's the premise and the talent behind it that makes me go, oh, I'm going to see this no matter what. The trailer actually didn't do a very good sell for me. So that's why I'm like, I'm looking at the talent. I'm looking at this idea as more of an awesome kind of, now I'll see it because of that.
Sure. Well, and also I think too, you know, just as horror fans, if you're watching this, it might be a good idea to support a completely original idea,
absolutely.
You know, considering that the two movies we just talked about are all based on pre-existing properties. So that's kind of interesting. But we'll all be able to judge for ourselves as Abattoir hits theaters and VOD on December 9th, 2016. And fun fact, I looked up what the word Abattoir means, and it means a slaughterhouse. So
nice. There it is.
I was going to say they should change it to the murder rooms of Jebediah Crone or something like
that.
I like Abattoir.
That's gonna roll off the tongue for sure.
The weird, strange murder rooms of kooky, crazy guy Jebediah Crone.
Even better.
Yeah, nailed it. Why aren't you in marketing? Come
you
on.
You should do the VO for the trailer.
There
too.
You go.
No.
In a world. All right. Well, let's go ahead and move into our favorite TV Times, appropriately titled, What's in the
What's
Box?
In the box?
What's in the box? So first, I want to tell you guys, The Exorcist. Yes, I'm watching it. I see you. We all see you. We all hear you. If you watch the show, you know we don't really do weekly recaps. But I can say that Collider Nightmares is cooking up something very, very cool involving The Exorcist that hopefully happens. We don't know if it will, but as soon as we get confirmation, you will be the first to know. And we will certainly be talking about the show after the season finale. So keep watching for more Exorcist coverage. But we're right there with you. That ish cray. Okay, let's move on. So first up, in an interview with Crave Online and future Schmodown champion William Bibbiani, mark my words, he is going to, no one's going to be able to beat him.
He is a beast.
He is a beast. M. Night Shyamalan gave an update on what fans can expect from his Tales from the Crypt series coming next year to TNT. Shyamalan did confirm that the series would pull directly from the comics and that fans can expect the dark, un-PC sense of humor will be out in full force. Shyamalan recalled his first memories of the HBO series, saying, to me, I grew up in an immigrant Indian house, so it was very forbidden. Even HBO at the time, it was like, that was not appropriate. You shouldn't be watching it. We shouldn't have that. So I'd sneak over to my friend's house and sleep over there and watch the show. The Split director continued, explaining that Tales from the Crypt was perfectly in line with his sensibilities as of late, explaining, you can see it in the stuff I'm interested right now, right? You know, that dark kind of, this was inappropriate, funny, scary, weird, that funny, scary mix. Now, Split arrives in theaters in January 2017, and Tales from the Crypt will arrive on TNT next year. So, Perri, we have seen Split, and we cannot get into that right now for fear of spoilers. But I really liked what Knight had to say about that funny, scary mix, because we've talked about it on this show before. I think that the Tales from the Crypt sensibilities are really in line with his body of work for the most part. And I think The Visit and Split fall right into that. But what would you say about that?
110% agree. I feel like I wouldn't be as enthusiastic about this story had I not just seen Split. There's so many things in that movie and The Visit that suggest this is the guy to do the series. And I know we're always nervous because he had a pretty significant lull, but you know, when I loved what, not to make this about Split, but when he introduced the movie at AFI Fest, he gave a whole big speech about, you know, how different it is to assemble your own team and make something within the constraints of a smaller budget. And just it came across as though he found a story he wanted to tell, and he 110% committed to telling it his way. And I feel like if he takes the same approach to this series and, for lack of better terms, just goes batshit with these stories however he wants, and he really commits to that, this could be a perfect pairing, and he could have a heck of a 2017.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, I've said it on this show before, and I'll say it again. Like, Lady in the Water is an example of a movie that I hate. I mean, I think it is unredeemable. I can't even watch it and enjoy how bad it is. Like, I love Knight, and I think that he is incredibly talented, but I do not like that movie. However, in a 44-minute sort of this type of show, whether it was, you know, a Tales from the Crypt or whether it was a Twilight Zone or something where you can enter that fantastical mindset for 44 minutes, get the point across and be done, maybe I could have enjoyed the Lady in the Water story. So, Schnepp, I want to ask you now, I know you did not love Split, but even so, seeing what he's done lately with things like The Visit and Split and that tone, and being a fan of the comics yourself, do you think that this is a good match?
Strangely, I think this is a great match. I mean, I think M. Night's sensibilities are perfect for Tales from the Crypt, so it makes my heart sing to hear that he's doing this, because I think of all the filmmakers involved who've ever wanted to make or even directed certain episodes from the old Tales from the Crypt, this guy is made for Tales from the Crypt. So, you know, I didn't hate Split. I just didn't like it. I think maybe if it was a Tales from the Crypt episode, I would have actually thoroughly enjoyed it, and it didn't have that specific ending that was on there. But, hey, look, Tales from the Crypt, if it's in his hands, I think it's going to work really well from all the body of his entire, all of his work. So I'm really happy to see what he does.
Reilly, how about you?
Yeah, I'm with you. I love the idea of a dark un-PC, and that is going to jump from the comics. That's where you need to start. And I love, I always feel like with Knight's movies, there is a sort of humor underneath it all. So that's where I can look at this and go, yeah. Because I did watch a lot of the HBO Tales from the Crypt. So to think about it through the lens of M. Night is fascinating to me. And so everything he's saying here is awesome, that, you know, he kind of grew up with it as well. And this, take it from the comics. I never got into the comics. I know, Schnepp, you're a huge fan of them.
Yeah, I've read all of them.
Yeah, yeah. So the fact that you've read all of them and you like this idea, and then I haven't seen Split, can't comment on it, but love The Visit. Surprised the hell out of me. So I'm glad to see that he seems to be, and then based on some reactions that people are having from Split, feels like he's back on his game, and that's what gets me more excited even for this.
Nice. Well, TNT, if you're watching Collider Nightmares, which I know you do every week, please feel free to bring all of us to the set and let us play around on the Tales from the Crypt
Who
set.
Who is the Crypt Keeper?
we can't wait. We're so excited. So we'll stay tuned for more from Tales from the Crypt. And next up, Channel Zero, Candle Cove, came to a close last Tuesday night. And with it came the first teaser for the follow-up season, Channel Zero, No End House. Deadline describes the sophomore season as, quote, a six-episode standalone anthology series inspired by Brian Russell's Creepypasta, and it features Margot Sleater, played by Amy Forsyth, as a young woman who visits the No End House, a bizarre house of horrors that consists of a series of increasingly disturbing rooms. When she returns home, Margot realizes that everything has changed, and John Carroll Lynch co-stars. So before we throw up our spoiler alert and get into a recap of Candle Cove, let's talk about this teaser real fast. Now, it's obviously quick. It is a teaser, and we know that the season two has wrapped production. I think this is so weird and creepy and cool, and I think that Candle Cove was a great way to introduce audiences into this universe, and now to see this trailer kind of piggybacking on top of that, it was a great combination. But how did it work for you guys, this quick teaser?
I loved it. I mean, this had like elements of Phantasm. It had all these really cool elements in there, but plus it felt original, creepy. I mean, that's what's exciting about, what is it called again?
Channel Zero.
Sorry, I was going to say Creepypasta.
There's a lot of words.
Creepypasta. It's a delicious. I think this is great. These are like horror Black Mirrors, but done as six episodes. So I think if you haven't seen Black Mirror yet, check it out. I mean, I haven't watched all of Channel Zero yet, so it's cool. I'm going to get spoiled just like you once that spoiler thing comes up. But this No End's house, I cannot wait to see it. I cannot wait to get freaked out and get to that sixth house. Sounds weird.
Perri. Solid trailer. There's no doubt in my mind, though, that it made me a million times more excited because I have seen the first season. I feel like that was almost... I don't know if I would have had the same reaction had I not watched Candle Cove and then seen that, even though I really like the idea of that kind of haunted house type thing, and I thought it looked beautiful, too. And, I mean, John Carroll Lynch, you put him in something, and I'm probably going to watch it no matter what, but... Having seen what they did with Candle Cove and getting a slight taste of what they could do with this concept, oh man, I can't wait for the show to come back. I'm so glad they shot the thing already.
Now, Reilly, I know that the pilot of Candle Cove didn't excite you the way that maybe some of us, you know, had a reaction to it. With that being said, what was your reaction to this season two teaser?
Maybe it's because of my love for horror houses or endless horror houses, No End House. This got me. I dug this little teaser, and it makes me want to go back and finish the first season of Candle Cove. I wasn't crazy about the pilot or the first episode. I saw a lot of potential, and so I need to revisit it and give it a chance. I said I would, and I just haven't got around to it. But this, I love where they're going with this. I'm a sucker for haunted house kind of anything, so this kind of it's intriguing.
Well, and I love how they kind of True Detective'd it in that there's one director on each season.
Yeah.
Different writers, definitely a writer's room, but one director giving a cohesive vision. And I think when creepy is your medicine, essentially, like that's the thing about this show. This show isn't going to jump out and scare you. It's got this creep factor that is just so twisted. And I think that if you have one director sort of like wading through those waters and guiding you, and it's about pacing, that really, really helped the first season. So Cody, if you don't mind, do we have the spoiler alert? Thank you. All right, so we'll put that up there. So Perri and I have finished season one, and we're just gonna give our reactions to it. Why don't you start?
So I wasn't on the show when you guys did the pilot discussion. So when you brought this up, I'm like, ooh, what's that? I don't know. I just like saw it around Twitter. I'm so glad I watched this. I understand, Reilly, why you might not have been into it after the pilot, because a big part of the reason this whole show as a whole, not as single episodes, worked for me was because it had one director who had a very clear understanding of the pace of the show that was consistent from start to finish, the visual style of the show, which was consistent from start to finish. And it just, I binged the whole thing.
And the performances, if I could just interject.
The performances as well. It's, you can, when you watch all six episodes, you really do see that it came from one mind, came from one leader, and I think it served the show exceptionally well. I was just so excited by the fact that everything in this was so original.
Yes.
I think that was just some, I was elated from start to finish. Every single time we got to see the Candle Cove footage, all those creepy puppets, and just, I mean, they went far with the violence. The spoiler alert's up. I'm going to say the moment that had me like, holy shit, out loud is when they killed Jess.
Which one's Jess?
The sheriff's wife.
Yes. Oh, yes.
I couldn't believe
like,
it.
Like, creepy kids done well. Wow. And shot in such a way that was, it reminded me of Zodiac. The kill on the side of the beach where you just see the Zodiac stabbing those people. And it's not sensationalized. It's very stark. You know what I mean? Like, very, and you hear the sound of that just like, oh my God. And
she was also one of the biggest, most main characters you can get. And I don't know, just the fact that she was a mother of children, I never, ever saw that coming. I was sure there was going to be a moment in that scene where she gets out, and just the blocking of that scene, the way they shot it, her trajectory as she comes out of the house, that was probably hands down my favorite sequence of the entire show.
Yeah, it was a very cool season. And I also wanted to give maybe the art direction some love.
Oh, yeah.
Because in addition to the puppets, all of the nightmare creatures that you see are so like, there's just something about it where it feels original. Mm-hmm. Now, these are concepts that are not necessarily revolutionary in that, you know, a monster from another world that like doesn't really have a face or something like that, which we kind of see in the end, but or in the last episode. But yet he looked so, and he moved so differently. Mm-hmm. It's like, and almost in that other world, when we finally do go into Eddie's world and we see, it's not skin flaps that are hate, but it didn't feel like skin to you?
It looked a little like skin. It also felt like a warped version of a child's fort, too.
Yeah,
like,
yes,
like if he had draped a sheet around his bedroom or something. But more horror filmmakers, TV makers, whatnot, should look at this series and just see the potential of creating an original idea like this, where this show just essentially made its own rules the entire time. And because it did it so well, I mean, I've said this on a number of shows, whether we're talking about TV, movies, anything. I'm a very logical person. I like to play by rules. I like to know if you get bit by a zombie, you turn like this. This show doesn't work like that. And I never second guessed it.
Yeah.
Not once the entire time, because I was so invested in the characters. I had so much fun with the whole Candle Cove concept. I'm really just shocked by how much I enjoyed this.
It's great. It's a great step in the right direction for sci-fi, too. You know, I mean, I've been singing the praises of 12 Monkeys for a long time. Mm-hmm. I think this show is incredible. They've got a lot of stuff that they were developing with Wes Craven before he passed that I really hope somebody continues, because I think those ideas are brilliant. The one thing I would say about Candle Cove that is, and it's not a criticism, but it's just something that I think could have been done differently. I felt like Candle Cove could have been a movie. Meaning, I feel like Candle Cove could have been condensed into 90 minutes or 2 hours. Now, I'm not saying by any means that it was boring, that I didn't enjoy the show. I just felt like with the material that was actually there, story-wise, and the scares or set pieces, it could have been a really intense 120 minutes as opposed to a slow burn 6 hours. Now, again, not a criticism. It works, and it's a great show, and I love the show. But this is the first time in a long time, as an avid person who's always like, ooh, this could be a TV show. Ooh, that should be a TV show, that I thought, you know, I would have liked for this to maybe be a movie. And that's just a side comment.
That's a fair point. It's slow.
Yeah.
And again, just like you said, that's not a criticism. Mm-mm. It's just the nature of the show. It's a slow burn until you get to the outright crazy stuff.
Yeah, and there's a sense of dread through every single episode. Mm-hmm. Like, the team who made this show, they kept that energy, which is so hard to do.
That's the only thing that makes me think it wouldn't have worked as a movie, is so much of the scare factor comes from the building dread and the townspeople, you know, not believing Eddie when he tries to tell him what's up here. Did I say the
Mike?
Wrong brother? I meant Mike.
Is his name Mike?
Mike is
yeah,
the main brother. But not believing him and just seeing the lengths that they go to in order to get answers. I feel like if you didn't have all of that, I don't want to call it misdirection, but veering away from what actually is going on there, I don't know if the ending would have been as satisfying.
I have a question for both of you. Like, I watched episode one, and then the next week I watched episode two, and then got super busy and didn't see the other four. Did you watch it every week? Because I know you just said you watched
all six. Yeah. I watched it pretty much every week.
Maybe that could be the difference between, like, you know, yeah, you feeling it's totally stretched out, because, like, I'm going to watch all four of them. So I'm wondering if I'll feel like, oh, my God, I can't wait to get to the next one. Because even when you're, like, doing something like Black Mirror, you're like, I tried to save them because I didn't want to watch all of them in one night.
So. Yeah. Yeah, that's actually a very fair point. The way you consume the show could definitely have something to do with how the pacing feels. I did watch it week to week, so that might have something to do with it. So Candle Cove is streaming on sci-fi.com. Definitely check it out. And Channel Zero, No End House, is coming sometime in 2017. And now we're going to roll into another TV recap that we're all going to join in on. I'm sure it's the one you've been waiting for. American Horror Story Roanoke came to a close last week, and with it came a little piece of viral marketing, possibly for the already greenlit seventh season of Ryan Murphy's anthology horror show. A quick video of ocean waves crashing with the words "sweet dreams" over them, and the caption "the monsters are all gone" below it, intercut with images of the weird wooden dolls from Roanoke that quickly returned to ocean waves, has appeared online. American Horror Story is officially exhausting. There's way too much going on. Real fast before we get into our feelings about Roanoke, like, do you think that after the marketing that they did for season six, where they teased 30 potential themes, do you think that this is kind of cut from that same cloth? Because then again, there are a lot of people that say, hey, in the final episode, the ship, that wooden ship, crashes to the ground, and maybe they're connected somehow, or maybe it's just a big distraction. I don't know.
Oh, God, I have no idea. I just thought you just exhausted me thinking about there's another marketing campaign coming for seven where it's just going to just, here's everything, you decide. I thought it was really fun for me to get back involved with American Horror Story to, like, I turned around, bless you, I turned around on the marketing because I was like, ooh, now it's must-see TV for me. I have to go check out what is this. And then we'll get to my thoughts later. So I don't want to see that again. I like the idea of this being connected somehow to Roanoke, but I just don't know how it's going to be. I know we're in North Carolina, and we could be in finally see the coast now, and it's connected that way. But I think they should move on from Roanoke. That's my opinion, and not connect it.
Yeah, so. I could see that, guys. How about you? What in terms of this quick little teaser that popped online? Do you think it means anything?
I don't care what it means. I don't want any more of these quick little teasers.
Yeah.
I mean, you all probably saw, I was completely exhausted, just like you said, by the marketing campaign for six. I thought it was obnoxious and manipulative. It wasn't fun for me at all, which is weird because I'm a diehard American Horror Story fan. Yeah. I will follow this show for however long it goes and feel the need to watch it no matter what. That just felt like them jerking me around. The big conclusion, the big reveal was not satisfying at all. And I don't think it served the show in any way. And the thought of having to go through that process again is just awful. I'm dreading it if that's what they're doing.
Schnepp.
I just want to see like 10 episodes of pilgrims killing each other.
I do too, actually.
So hopefully that's what it is. It's gonna, some dumb ship and then they get murdered. I don't know.
Or ghost ship or
ghost
something.
Ship. Ghost pilgrims.
All right, let's go ahead and put our spoiler alert up. So Roanoke essentially, was had a lot to do with reality television, had a lot to do with true crime and things like that. And I'm going to let you, who wants to jump in? Because I did not like this season.
Okay, I'll start. I enjoyed the hell out of maybe 7 episodes, and then I really fell off a cliff. I mean, and I was pushed by American Horror Story Season 6. I thought it was bold what they did. I was totally on board. I loved the idea of the recreations, the actors, and then the real people. It really worked for me, and there was truly terrifying moments. I jumped a number of times. I dug it. I was involved with all of them. And then when it switched, and it had that 180 turn where then we get the bat, we're like, now we're behind the scenes of a reality show season 2. I was still on board. I'm like, okay, all right. I don't know what I think yet, but I'm going to hang on. I'm going to hang on. And then it turned into found footage, and about 8, 9, 10, you lost me, because I didn't think the rules matched up. I think the found footage was exhausting. Like you said, we keep using that word. I don't think it played by the rules. I was so frustrated that they were picked. Oh my God, there's something trying to kill us. Let me just get it on tape here. I'm sorry, that's ridiculous. I would be bolting through the woods, leaving everything behind. I wouldn't want anything to hold me down so I could get away from whatever the hell is going on. And how many times, I couldn't buy it. How many times are we gonna keep going back to the house with another film crew? And then, I mean, it's like you saw it with the second half, they all died. So why are these people going? It just didn't make sense to me.
With no real payoff, I would say. So this was one of my biggest problems, was that I tried to see somebody saying that it was a commentary on the media and culture.
I get it.
But it didn't make a point. Mm-hmm. To me, there was no point here. Because, you know, you have the reality TV show producer who'll stop at nothing to get ratings. Yeah, but he dies like 2 seconds later and there's no payoff for that. And then they dabbled in portraying addiction, right? Which Hotel did, I think, far superior, mm-hmm. more superior. But then they kind of dropped that too. They started, this goes back to my bigger thing with this whole season. They started making a lot of different points and then just totally dropped them. They started with the interracial couple in the South and the people who, you know, the culture clash, like with the Polk family. Okay, so are we gonna, well, no, the Polks are just kind of crazy and inbred, and which turns into every other stereotype. I don't know. It just, for me, there was no substance to this whole season, and that made it very hard for me to engage.
Oh God, it felt like they were a slave to this concept, that they couldn't do anything but focus on this concept and play it out because it had so many twists and turns. And like I said, I was such a fan of it. I thought it was bold, and I was with them. And then you say all that, Clark, and I'm like, my God, there were so many missed opportunities, including just kind of going into the Roanoke legend.
Exactly.
I never got like my fill of the actual legend of Roanoke. It was just, nope, it's about reality television.
Well, and I looked up The Butcher, because a lot of times American Horror Story will pull famous people from history and either embellish their legend or, you know, build upon that. And Thomason, which is the name of The Butcher, she was a real woman. However, there's like no records of her. Basically, her husband was one of the original settlers. He went back over to Europe. He came back and she was dead, or she was gone. Okay, but that's literally it. Like, there's no myth. They just pulled a name from history and created The Butcher. And by the way, the Blood Moon and the idea of The Butcher, great concepts. Mm-hmm. Why do we have to tie this to Roanoke, which is one of the most compelling and interesting American legends, but then totally not use that? Like, mm-hmm. I just feel like they should have called it Blood Moon. But
ooh,
I know you guys have things to say too, so please.
Well, I mean, I actually really love the series. I'll say this, out of the 10 episodes, yeah, I like 2 or 3 of them felt like stretched out and didn't work. So, I mean, I wish they just made a 7-episode season, because then it would have really, really worked for me, because I love the premise of the reenactments. That was like a shot in the arm that I think the series needed. I thought it was original. It was really fun.
Yeah.
Where you see the actual real person and then the actor portraying them. Absolutely loved it. And I think they pulled it off
quite well for like three episodes. I started to get bored by the fourth and fifth episode, so I was really happy that it was almost like complete reboot by, I think it was episode, was it six
five,
or five?
Five or six.
Where
yeah.
they did like a sort of behind the scenes, this reality show. Once again, all of a sudden I felt like I'm watching a brand new series, but like a twist on the first five. So I thought it was incredibly fun, but it started to fall into the same tropes of like it got boring and repetitive, like, oh, here's a new crew. I felt, to be honest with you, though, I really liked the way they pulled off all the found footage and the live action. I mean, the use of the cameras in some ways were better than the newer Blair Witch to me, the way they actually cut things together. I got more freaked out. It made a giant jump scare for me when that gal was driving away and the pig showed up and she flipped. Mm-hmm. I actually jumped out of my couch. I was like, whoa. I mean, that's pretty rare to get freaked out and scared at home on a TV show. So I think they did a really good job. It just kind of fell apart. I see what you're saying. It didn't really, I don't really need things to tie up or have some point. I mean, I don't mind if they like touch on certain hot button issues. Nothing is going to wrap up. We all get to die. You know what I mean? We just, you know, if you want to get grim about it. But to me, it's like it did kind of like fall apart at the end. So.
Perri?
Yeah. I admire what they were trying to do with the found footage show element of it. I thought that was a really interesting way to structure the season, and it was kind of fun going from one to the next and seeing how having experienced one before the other would change things. And I liked that scene where you cut back to the cast and the real people in front of the audience. I thought that was really impactful based on where it was positioned in the season. My biggest problem with this whole thing is that I think the ending felt kind of pointless, because the end of the show wound up being all about a character or characters we didn't care about. Of all people, the main character in the end that you're supposed to finish is Lee.
Yeah.
Is really Lee weird. And Flora? Right. Who cared about Flora and who cared about Priscilla? It was just such a weird place to have ended. I didn't like episode 10 at all. I was liking what they did with 9, but they definitely needed to find a better place to finish. Riley, you had said this before, and this is what it feels like during pre-production, is that it felt like they didn't know where they were going, and they just randomly pinpointed Lee as the person to finish the season in the end. And it was a really odd and unsatisfying choice. I think they did a good job in terms of bringing back Sarah Paulson's character from Asylum, and that was a nice organic way to connect it, maybe, but everything with Lee in the end felt forced and unnecessary. And I think one of the points that you just made could have fixed a lot of this season for me too, which is all the stuff with Roanoke, I think, needed to go, and it needed to be a completely original tale, because there were so many things that I was aware of about Roanoke that I was sitting there, I'm like, oh, when are we going to get that? When are we going to get that? And what we got of the actual legend through the reenactments was, it didn't mean anything to me at all. I didn't really quite understand, you know, what the butcher was after with her son and that stupid witch. If anything, maybe it made it, the Kathy Bates role in the middle portion of the season never would have worked without the reenactment stuff, obviously, but otherwise, all that material meant nothing to me, especially in comparison to the reenactment with the other people, and then seeing them with the, you know, the actors paired with the real people later on, although Sarah Paulson's accent in this season drove me off my mind. I'm not good with accents. I don't know how accurate she was, but it was so freaking distracting.
It just felt like high school theater to me. Like, it felt like, it just felt like, you know, we're all in a scene and just improv it. And it was just like, I don't want to watch this. And Sarah Paulson is an incredible actress, but I don't really need to see her play three different characters in 10 episodes. That was too much for me. It was too much for me. I don't know.
I feel like if it was three sections, it would have been better. If you had boiled it down to, you know, the actual show with the interviews and the reenactment. Then you put them all back in the house and then maybe cap it off with the kids going back with the found footage cameras. I don't know. Maybe that would have felt a little more structured.
I would have liked it like what you said. Like, it starts out with the reenactments. Then it's the found footage. But that was, those were like three episodes each, and the last four episodes are actually Roanoke, like with the pilgrims.
Yeah.
And stuff. That would have been really weird, where you would have found out a lot of stuff that already happened, but the you know, behind the scenes of the behind the scenes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, all right. Any final words?
I still liked it. If the last episode sucked, I'll say that. You know, like episode 10 was like disappointing, mm-hmm. the way it all kind of like felt, you know. It was like didn't wrap up in the right way, at least like the way I think any of us wanted it to. But then again, it did wrap up, and there's like, okay, that's how it's going to end. I guess poo on that. But yeah. I love the rest of it. I love the chances that they took. They did take a lot of risks by doing that, like right mid-season, like, what am I watching? It was super exciting, and it completely worked because I was about to stop watching the series. And then that happened, it just reinvigorated it. So for me, I mean, am I going to rewatch it again? Probably not, but I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I think maybe it's so funny because if you look at my Twitter timeline, I was like praising this thing. I was having the best time. And I guess it's just an immense amount of disappointment that it didn't pay off, because I really thought they were doing something very special with it. Like you said, Schnepp, it was just a shot in the arm. It was very different. I dug it. I came in late. You know, I only saw first season. Now I got to go back and watch a lot of them. So I was like, wow, this is really great. I'm admiring it. But to have it not pay off and to have it just get all mixed up and all over the place where the rules weren't matching up in my mind, even the end with the spirit hunters, it's like they're using their fancy equipment and they're seeing things crawl on the wall, but that just didn't make sense in the world that they had already created.
You know, Hunters was the absolute worst part of this season.
You nailed it with that.
If you had just taken that out.
Yeah. No. Yeah. Not taking it out, but just explored it. Like what you're saying is that they introduced so many things and then dropped by the wayside. Like they were like, when they were like, oh, we set up all these things to freak them out. We set up all these special effects and contraptions, and none of them, they never do
anything.
They
never
did
anything.
That's
totally
what I'm saying. Yeah. Everything that they set up, even what you're talking about, oh, with the, you know, the weird, creepy cannibals, and they have this racial thing. It's like that didn't, a lot of the things that were set up didn't pay off. And then when you keep doing that time and time, episode after episode, it becomes frustrating. And that's when you're like, why did it end with this? And why did it end with, you know, this stupid like interview with this other character? It's like that's a true kind of lazy writing.
It's also unfortunate because the spirit hunter thing basically just repeated things that had happened twice over rather than exploring new things or exploring other concepts that they had just introduced more deeply. So it was just such a big fat waste of time. It's like, what's the difference between those kids and the spirit hunters except for the fact that someone says they have a show?
They could have so easily just dropped the found footage angle. Just go to narrative.
Yeah.
Let me see Lee talk to Flora. Let me see their relationship. Spend that last 25 minutes. Get out of here, spirit hunters, and let me see these two characters actually connect so that I care when the mother sacrifices herself.
Yeah.
Like, why are we beholden to this silly thing?
Well, and they did kind of do that. All of a sudden, it was jarring. They kind of switched the narrative, and they go in, and then the house blows up.
Right.
And you're like, okay, we just dropped it. That's what I mean. It was like they were a slave, like I said, to the concept, but they couldn't do the juggling act. It's like they had all these dishes in the air, and they all just went everywhere and shattered, and I was like, what was that?
I feel like they just like drew straws, and whoever got the winner was the character who survived, and then they had to fashion the whole narrative around that.
Probably
it. Well, all right, those are our thoughts for American Horror Story Roanoke. I'm sure you guys will have more to say.
Yeah.
And now I guess we have to whiz through the rest of our show because we're going long. But let's get into our jump scare of the week.
Yeah.
Creepy. So once again, Collider Nightmares viewer Chris D'Onofrio has done my homework for me.
Chris.
Thank you, Chris. He asked a question on Twitter that I thought was great. Horror's influence on film, creatively and financially, is undeniable. Oh, God. Look at that. Ray.
Black Phillip and a clown.
Get out of here,
this is
Ray.
True nightmares.
So he said the influence is undeniable, though after a century, it's still the black sheep. Why? Great question.
That'd be a great team-up movie.
A literal
right.
black
Pennywise
sheep.
With
a very
Pennywise
tiny clown.
With black
yeah, just riding the black sheep.
To answer this question, what I think in a very concise, short way, I think it's because horror and this type of thing makes people uncomfortable. And audiences don't like to be uncomfortable. They certainly don't like to be uncomfortable when it comes to darkness. And so I think like when you watch a drama, like when you watch Schindler's List, that makes you feel uncomfortable, right? Because it's horrific. But there's something dramatic about it, and it's an epic drama story as opposed to something that scares you and makes you uncomfortable. And with comedy, you know, I mean, I think comedy can certainly make you feel uncomfortable, but it's a more accepted kind of discomfort, whereas horror, I think, brings you to your fears and brings you to the things that terrify you. And people don't like being scared, you know, they get defensive. And so I think that's why. I think ultimately people don't respect the genre because it makes them feel discomfort in a way that they don't think is that is the most primal of their discomfort.
Certain people don't like
that's
being
true.
Scared.
Yeah.
But I know what you're saying. Yeah. I mean, but it also falls into like religious aspects where it's like that's one of the things where it's like, hey, like if it's about Satan, don't go see that mm-hmm. movie. Or it's the dark side as well when you're talking about murderers and serial killers, the reality of the horrible side of human nature. That's also a frightening thing that a lot of people don't want to explore. They don't read about serial killers or mass murderer books. They probably won't go see the movies. Then you also have just the ideas of the fantastical might upset someone. I have nightmares because of that creature, that alien, so they don't want to go see films like that. I mean, really, it is like it's a percentage of people who love that kind of thing. And obviously, all of us are those people. But I look at it in the same vein as science fiction. It's like, you know, it's always going to have its fan base, but I don't think it's going to be like every single person's like, I can't wait to see this sci-fi movie of the week. So
right.
Yeah, I think you hit it there, Clark. I was going to say it probably does make people uncomfortable, and I think they don't even. I think the broad, like my mother, I'm going to bring my mother into this. She won't even for a minute think about going to see Don't Breathe. Mm-hmm. You know, she'll see the trailer and be like, nope. And will not even give it any thought after that. So it's like they don't take it serious. Mm-hmm. I think it's just because of that. I think we've already said it. Makes them uncomfortable. It's those things that you don't want to face, which the monsters in your closet, mm-hmm. the serial killers that could live down the street from you. But I got to say, I think we're seeing a resurgence. We've mentioned it a lot on the show this year for horror movies. Their studios are taking it seriously. Yep. It's not a black sheep in their development slate because they're looking at, I mean, look at Don't Breathe. I mean, it shot on $10 million and it's made, what, $100 million now? It's,
150.
Yeah. So we're getting a sequel. So there's no black sheep in the development halls of these studios who are looking at the returns and going, yep, they want to see this. It's more of the audience. And yeah, it's a great question, too, because I don't think you can really nail it right on the head, but I think you did a pretty good job on that point.
It's just the nature of horror. I think it's just so polarizing that mm-hmm. you're going to have people like us that it's like, oh, horror, and then you're going to have people who just write it off immediately and give it a title like a black sheep kind of position. And it's really the same thing with any genre that I think goes to an extreme. If you have a really, you know, crazy, gross comedy, it's okay to bring my mother into it. You know, she's never going to want to see a comedy that's all about, like, you know, poop and fart jokes right. or has Will Ferrell acting like a lunatic in it. And it's the same way where there's some people that love that kind of humor, so they're going to go for it. But another polarizing thing about horror is that oftentimes the movies are either absolutely fantastic, like Don't Breathe or The Conjuring, where everybody's talking about it. It makes an insane amount of money, and it's like, wow, look at what they accomplish. Or it's absolute garbage, yeah. and it's, you know, the fifth movie in whatever franchise. I feel like, I don't have stats on this, but I feel like more horror movies go straight to DVD than any other genre Definitely. Out there. So it's just the fact that you are on one end of the spectrum or the other, and that immense middle ground probably leaves a lot of people to label horror this
way.
Well,
you also brought up something where it's like horror films aren't taken seriously.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So like they aren't even taken, like when a horror film comes out, they're not even seen as in the same bracket as other movies. Oh, it's just a horror movie. Well, what kind of horror movie? So it's its own sub niche.
Agreed, 100%. Well, thank you, Chris, for the wonderful question. And speaking of questions, let's get into our Twitter questions. So just so you guys know, the end of the year is approaching, in case you didn't know that already. And I need more Twitter questions. So even if I don't use them every week, I always screen grab them and I put them in a little folder on my laptop. And I pull from them you know, after, well, sometimes well after they've been asked. So please send them. A lot of you guys have said you enjoyed our kill list segments. If you liked those and you have ideas for what you'd like a kill list to be, please send them our way. Do it on Twitter and use the hashtag Collider Nightmares. First up, TJ Dex, hashtag Movie Squad, says, what's the best time period to film a horror slash genre movie? For me, I think that horror is best when technology is sort of removed from the equation. There's just something a little simpler. And for me as an audience member, it allows me to believe a little quicker.
I'll go the opposite. I love when horror and technology are fused, like David Cronenberg's work. So, I mean, but, you know, I think current day, like modern times for me, work. And as we progress forward, then we watch movies from, you know, oh, that's from the 70s. Well, it was made in the 70s. Mm-hmm. Or you can go back to the 70s. So I don't mind if it's taking place in ye olden times of the 70s, but I would prefer nowadays.
I think every time is a good time, but my sensibilities put me in the modern time period, and we all know I love technology. I like movies like Unfriended, and I do like the challenge that incorporating technology poses, which is figure out a way to do it, but that'll still make it not feel dated and still leave people enjoying it years down the line. So I would lean towards modern times.
Yeah, I think it's always contingent on just the story you're trying to tell. There isn't a good time. I mean, I'm going to watch modern, and I'm going to love a 70s based because of what you even said, Clark, getting rid of the technology. Like, again, it's the story. I mean, I hate it when we're in the middle of nowhere in modern times, and oh, my cell phone isn't working. That pulls you right out.
I was about
to
say, I want to see someone do a horror film where everyone's cell phone
works.
Yeah, there's no dropout. They're like, I don't know. Ah, my neck is being cut off. You know, it's like, my head is being severed while yelling in a phone. That'd
right.
be amazing.
Yeah, but it's all about the story. So you could put it anytime. I mean, I happen to gravitate towards The Exorcist and Halloween, obviously. So I love that time period of the 70s because it just seemed like it just. It's like a snapshot of history, of very scary history, depending on what you're telling. So, yeah.
Wonderful. And finally, Dick Baxter asks.
There it is.
I don't know what you heard. I heard something different.
What did I say? I don't know what you heard, but Dick Baxter asks, would you want to see a sequel to It Follows? Great question. No.
Yeah. I would love to see a sequel to It Follows, but if they call it, this should be They Follows, or have two of them, like two of those weird, you know, creatures that are both competing to like absorb somebody's soul or something. I don't know.
Yeah. I'll take that. I love It Follows. So if there's a story that can work for a sequel, then I'm all for it. But I hesitate to say yes because I thought it was such a great original horror story that, you know, where do you kind of go after? I don't know. So again, show me the poster and give me a synopsis and then I'll decide.
I am intrigued just because I think it... Fuck me.
Oh my God. There it is.
Oh my God. Amazing.
There it is.
Amazing.
Off the rails. God.
This episode is rated R by the MPAA.
Well, we're talking horror and
It
Follows.
That's okay. Actually, that's our one. That's
it's
our
a PG-13.
PG-13.
Totally.
We get one.
Dropped one F-bomb.
I'm sorry. Okay. But I am intrigued just because I think it's such a brilliant concept. But I think, Riley, you just said it. As such a big fan of the original movie, it would make me nervous seeing them try to expand it. And I can't envision a movie where it continues with the same characters. Not that that would necessarily be the route they go. However, I think a really cool idea would be to turn It Follows into a TV show. Mm-hmm. Like, could you imagine a TV show and like even set in the 80s? Because obviously I have Stranger Things vibes still. Like set in the 80s in a high school where this disease just catches on. Like,
that's cool.
Oh, that would be such a brilliant idea. Mm. She's making faces.
You know what? In order for me to get onto the It Follows bandwagon, like another entry into the franchise, I would just need them to clarify the rules and stick to them.
Mm.
that's my biggest problem with the movie in the first place. So, yeah. Okay, well, that does it for us. Happy Thanksgiving to you guys. We hope you enjoyed the show. If you did, please tell your friends about us. Share the show, American Horror Story, Candle Cove, Walking Dead, all of the above. Thank you to my panel. Perri, where can they find you on the internet?
You guys can catch me on Twitter and Instagram at PNemiroff. Obviously, right here, Collider Nightmares every week. We also have Best of the Week every Saturday. We got the Walking Dead recap show, the Ash vs. Evil Dead recap show on Sunday. And yeah, go check that out. Happy Thanksgiving.
All right. And Mr. John Schnepp.
You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram, just at John Schnepp, on Collider Heroes every Tuesday on Movie Talk, Tuesday through Thursday, and a bunch of other places all around the world. Goodbye.
And Mr. Mark Reilly.
Find me at Reilly Around on Twitter and Instagram, on the Schmoes and O'Main Show every Thursday at 7. And I do Sunday mailbags here on Collider Video. I'll be back for Collider Nightmares.
Wonderful. And you can find me at Clarke Wolfe, Clarke with an E, Wolf with an E, and drinking my way through Thanksgiving. Thank there you all is. Again for watching. Don't forget to watch Movie Talk tomorrow. And until next time, we will see you in your nightmares.
Yeah. Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.